Good afternoon. So in this lesson, we're going to derive the equation, the heat equation for three-dimensional objects. So basically, an equation in which the temperature of the object at a given point depends on, in total, in four variables, right? So U of x, y, z, t will be the temperature at location x, y, z at time t. So first of all, make sure you know how the equation looks like in three dimensions. Then you're gonna, you know, connect it immediately with the two dimensions or the one dimension which we derived separately in the last lecture. Basically, this is the most general format we're gonna work with in this class. The actual way to derive it is different than in the book. So I encourage you actually to read the derivation in the book or from any other source you want. There are various ways to actually approach it. I like to give you a way that involves kind of heavily some calculus 3 stuff, because if you did that recently and you remember some of the concepts from calculus 3, I think it's a very, very nice way to understand how the equation is derived, and reinforces how powerful those tools we learn in calculus 3 are, in fact, especially in understanding the math behind some of these physical equations. So we have to go over a couple of preliminary stuff. If you really don't remember much from calculus 3, I suppose this derivation is not strictly mandatory, and just make sure you know how the equation looks like in the end. So let's go over a couple of things from calculus 3. So if you have a function of three variables, remember that the gradient, which is one particular case of a directional derivative, which is denoted like this, is just the vector of the partial derivatives. So in our case, the temperature gradient is going to be the gradient of u with respect to the space coordinates. So with respect to x, y, and z on, not the time. Because remember, this gives you the direction of heat flow, the opposite of the gradient. If you have, remember in the one-dimensional case, the heat flow is either from left to right or right to left. So if you have a drop in temperature from right to left, if you go from left to right on the x-axis, so if you have a drop in temperature, that means the gradient, the temperature gradient decreases, but then the flow is in the opposite direction. Here we are in 3D. So if you imagine this is a piece of the surface of that object, and let's say the gradient, the temperature gradient points this way, then the flow of the heat points in the opposite direction. So again, it should be pretty intuitive. If you have a point on the surface which is cold and a nearby point outside which is hot, then there is an increase in, you know, the gradient points, of course, from cold to heat, because it's an increase in temperature if you move from one point to another. But of course, the heat flows in the opposite direction from the hot point to the cold point. Similarly, if you have the gradient pointing the opposite way as before, toward the surface, that means you will have a cold point here and a hot point on the surface. The flow of the heat is away from the surface, I mean, from in the opposite direction, from hot to cold. So in the when we write the Fourier law of heat conduction, the flow of the heat is now a vector. So the heat flow is a function of x, y, z, t, which is minus k of x, y, z, which is the conduction term, now depending on the on three variables, x, y, z, dot product the gradient. So if you want to write it as a vector, this will be minus k u partial x minus k u partial y minus k u partial z. In the one-dimensional case, this will be just a regular function. Right? I mean, if you remember in the one-dimensional case, it was phi of x t minus k of x u partial x. It's just like the first component now of this equality in the three dimension. We're going to need also the divergence of a function later. So if you have also, if you have a vector field, let's say f of x, y, z, g of x, y, z, h of x, y, z, and let's call this, I guess, U, big U, the divergence of this big U would be the sum of the partial derivatives fx plus fy plus fz. We're going to use the divergence theorem at some point in the process of deriving this heat equation. All right, so let's say the object has a volume V and surface S. And we're going to write essentially, we're going to have to refer to the surface S because remember, the heat equation is derived by writing essentially the same quantity in two ways. At a given moment of time, T, we're going to have to write the total heat energy change inside the object. And that's going to be a triple integral because basically we're going to take a piece of the volume. Imagine you partition this object and you look at a small piece of the volume, dV, which was dx in the one-dimensional case. And then we're going to add up all the energy gain at these points, basically, and that'll be essentially a triple integral. But we're going to have the total energy gain or loss, net change in energy inside the object on the left side of the equation. And the same thing can be written as the net change between the heat flow across the surface. So imagine at each point on the surface, you're going to have the flow of the heat pointing either inward or outward, depending on what happens near that point on the surface. So there will be a surface integral on the right-hand side. That surface integral over the flow will give us the net flow of the heat exchange across the surface, which has to be equal to the net energy gain inside the surface, which will be another triple integral, which will be a triple integral on the left. So remember, there are also some physical constants which also depend on three coordinates now, the specific heat given by sigma of xyz and the density at that point. So on the left side of the equation, and remember the specific heat is the amount of energy to gain 1 degree for 1 unit of mass, right? So if you look at the point here of volume dV, if I multiply the density at that point with dV, I get the mass of that small piece. And because the specific heat is the amount of heat energy needed by 1 unit of mass to raise to 1 degree, if I multiply the actual mass by the specific heat, then I get essentially the energy required to raise or change that mass by 1 degree. But the actual change, remember, is given by the actual change in temperature, U of x, y, z, t, at time t. So when you multiply by U partial t, finally you get essentially the total energy change at the time t for that point of volume dV. So again, if it's not clear, everything besides U partial t is the total energy required by that mass at that point gain 1 degree. But U partial t is the actual net gain or loss in temperature. The number of degrees is given by U partial t. So this is what happens at that unit of that piece of the volume dV. When I triple integrate over that quantity, that gives me the overall energy change inside the object. So that is the left side of the equation. Okay. Now, what about the right hand side? Here's another little trick here to keep in mind, not trick, little important observation about the sign of the surface integral. So if I have basically, let's look at this arrow here. If I have, for example, the flow coming inward the object, the surface integral will be negative. By default, remember the surface integral takes the outward normal. So if I take the opposite, then that's going to be with the opposite sign. But that corresponds to a positive gain in the heat energy because the flow comes inside the object. Conversely, if the surface integral is positive, so if the flow is outward of the object, there's a heat loss in the object. So there's a loss in the heat energy inside the object. So the right-hand side should be minus the surface integral over the flow ds. That's the right side of the equation. And now let's replace the flow with minus k dot delta gradient of u. And so that's going to be these two basically minus signs cancel out. So the surface integral is going to be of this vector field, k dot product gradient. And, you know, remember as a vector, it's k of x, y, z. I'm not going to write of x, y, z so that I don't use too much space. K u partial x, k u partial y, k u partial z ds. And finally, the last step is to write this as a triple integral via the divergence theorem. The divergence theorem states that the surface integral over a vector field for a closed object is the triple integral over the divergence of that vector field. So the divergence of this vector field is the sum of the partial derivatives of each component. So partial x of the first component plus partial y of the second component plus partial z of the third component. And finally, this is the right side of the equation. So the left side of the equation is a triple integral over the volume V. The right hand side is another triple integral over the same volume V. Under some mild positivity condition, in continuity conditions, because the V is arbitrary, remember, we didn't make any assumptions about V. So really, V can be an arbitrary shape here. These two triple integrals are equal implies that the inside of each function is equal as well. So basically, the inside of the first triple integral, ut sigma delta, is equal to this summation. At this point, maybe you should pause and look at the notes and compare it to the one-dimensional case. In the one-dimensional case, it's very, very similar, except you have only one term, u partial x, and then sigma, delta, k, all of these were functions of x. Let's move on to the second page to finish up this. I'm going to rewrite it on the second page, and then we'll finish with some observations. All right, so this is the full equation. And I'm gonna, this time I wrote explicitly that sigma, delta, and k are functions of x, y, z. So that is essentially the heat equation in its most general form for a three-dimensional object. Once again, because we won't be able to do much with it in this general form, we make as a simplifying assumption that these physical constants, sigma, k, and delta, are constant. So they don't depend on the nature of the object. So because of that, then we will be able to replace, to pull the k out of the outside partial derivative. And then the equation becomes ut delta sigma. That's going to be a constant on the left side. And on the right-hand side, I can pull k, the conduction term, remember. And then inside, you're going to be left with u partial x twice, u partial y twice, u partial z twice. And just like the one-dimensional case, you can combine these physical constants into one constant. And then you can rename it k or a squared, so then that leads to the heat equation in three dimension given by ut, u partial t, k times uxx, uyy, uzz. And so clearly now you see that the two-dimensional case, if the object is just, you know, a plate in which there's no z-coordinate, so that means u, z, z will be zero. So of course the heat equation in two-dimensional will be just this. And then the variable will be depending on u, x, y, t. And in the case of the thin bar, the one-dimensional case, in that case u, y is zero, u, z is zero. There's only dependence on x, and that gives you the familiar already one-dimensional case in which u just depends on x and t. In this class, we will be able to solve PDEs in two variables. We will still deal with, you'll see later, how we can make the connections with higher dimensions, because there are related problems that can still be written in two variables, even though the object is in two dimensions, for example. So we'll get to that in due course. One last terminology before we call it a day. The right-hand side of the ODE, of the PDE, this this summation here is called the Laplacian of u of x, y, z. And it's denoted by delta u. So delta u is just u x x plus u y y plus u z z. So with this notation, the general heat equation in a more compact form can be written like this. There's another notation for the Laplacian, sometimes like this, nabla squared u. That's not really that important at this point. I just want you to be aware of these various notations for the right-hand side of the ODE and the name of it. So we're going to spend, like I said before, just you know, a couple of lectures, probably at least two lectures, in which we will play with writing down boundary conditions for various problems involving the heat equation. And after that, we're going to derive the wave equation and move on slowly to how we actually solve it. So that's it for today.